The inaugural event, really, for this year's talk is Professor Neel Ahuja, who's with us from the University of North Carolina at Chapel Hill. Neel Ahuja is really a terrific voice. As you'll see in his work, he's a professor of English and comparative literature, but his work is deeply historical. It's in dialogue with questions of science, questions of empire. As you'll see in this evening's talk, thinking about how primates have been part of both structures of racial oppression, structures of U.S. expansion, and he will really talk about how these are also questions about universities as well, the politics of knowledge. And this is something you all know about, how universities are themselves a site for terrible things. And so we are concerned with those terrible things, and Neel is one of these people who could talk about universities as a place of learning, but also a place of oppression. He has a history as an activist himself, as an academic, so he's really in some ways a terrific person to be part of this series that brings NARN and the UW working group together. So just join me in welcoming Neel Ahuja to Seattle.
Thank you all for coming tonight, and I want to especially thank Anika for setting things up and for inviting me to come. And of course, thanks to all of you for allowing me to share some of my research and experience tonight. And I'd love to hear also from you and to hopefully have some dialogue, because I know all of you have experiences working in different kinds of activism, or maybe from other areas I don't know about yet. So I hope we can have a conversation at the end. I'm also excited to be here because I personally have worked on primate campaigns in the past, and I don't solely work on animal issues in my research. I'm actually a professor of this thing called postcolonial studies, which is an attempt to, in many cases, to think about how the history of our academic knowledge in Western universities, Western educational institutions, has been shaped by the histories of inequalities in international power relationships. And so I'm interested in taking the conversations about primates and vivisection and animal experimentation and the ethics of it in the United States into a little bit of a global context in this talk. So I'm mostly going to today be giving a little bit of the prehistory of these institutions that we call the National Primate Research Centers, run by the National Institutes of Health. And I'm gonna talk about how they kind of came about historically. And this is definitely an international story. It's a story about medical researchers from the United States going abroad and actually harvesting these animals and bringing them back to the United States. And they were only able to do that because of certain international power relationships, because of the money and power of universities that were backing them, and because there were colonial governments ruling the ecological places where monkeys and apes reproduce outside of captivity. So I want to argue today that the lab, the primate lab as we know it, a militarized laboratory, a laboratory that's locked down, where monkeys and other primates are kept behind bars in small enclosed spaces, it wasn't something that had to be this way. Primate institutions were designed this way because of a set of geopolitical relationships that came about in large part because of a specific set of research priorities having to do with polio in the middle 20th century. So I'm going to try to go through what that research was, what it meant that researchers started kind of looking all over the world to different primate species, and then talk about how that impacted the formation of these primate institutions, and maybe talk a little bit also about what that means for animal activist campaigns trying to address the present day legacies of these histories. I'm also glad to be here in this particular area where there's not only a lot of primate experimentation going on, but a ton of really interesting primate animal activism, activism around primates, and animal care institutions too. I spent a little bit of time a couple years back interviewing staff at Chimpanzee Sanctuary Northwest. And even though I'm talking about rhesus monkeys today, the monkeys and the chimpanzees are linked in the story. So I hope that by the end of this, we can understand that. And I want to just put in our minds at the beginning that do people know that the NIH is kind of phasing out a big portion of its chimpanzee research? Yeah. That is directly related to rhesus monkeys, because if you look at the actual reports coming out of the NIH leading up to these decisions to cut the chimpanzee labs, John Vandenberg from the NIH basically has now finally, after years of being pushed, admitted that chimpanzees are intentional beings who have feelings, desires, can suffer. And that seems like a great victory. But the reason he's willing to acknowledge that is because then he goes ahead and says a second thing, which is chimpanzees require extra ethical justification for research, unlike rhesus monkeys, dogs, and rodents. And that decision, which is basically a budget-cutting decision to reduce the number of chimpanzees in federal labs, is directly linked to the expansion of these other types of research on other animals. All of that comes out of this history I'm going to tell today, linking research institutions in the United States to a primate laboratory in Puerto Rico, to harvesting of rhesus monkeys in India, and some short-lived attempts to gain access to chimpanzees in Central Africa. So I'm going to briefly talk about all of those sites, and then hopefully we can kind of discuss. To understand this story, I want us to think about what people feared in terms of their health that brought about these medical institutions, because they're really aimed at serving human health, and people were really scared about diseases. And if you think about the 1930s, one of the big differences is we didn't have the same kind of medical infrastructure that we do today. Everyday life wasn't something that we kind of medicalized. You don't always take a prescription drug every day. I take pills every day for various ailments. That wasn't exactly the kind of commonplace relationship to drugs in the 1930s. And at that time, they were just developing new antibiotic drugs. And there was all of this vaccine research, but there weren't really successful vaccines. The smallpox vaccine was basically the only successful one at that time. Between 1930 and 1960, we get the development of the world's first successful polio vaccines, which becomes seen as this medical watershed, right? Jonas Salk becomes this celebrity doctor for having developed the Salk vaccine for polio, which he releases to the public in 1955. And the way that our popular culture remembers this is that it was a heroic triumph of medical sciences and US government investments in the health of the nation. What we don't get in textbooks and documentaries that look back at that period of time in the mid-20th century is this really long story about medical researchers spending decades on an inaccurate model of polio transmission that they developed on rhesus monkeys. And they went and harvested hundreds of thousands of these monkeys, brought them over from India, and did this research to produce the first vaccines. So I'm going to talk a little bit about that first. The 1940s and 1950s are known as the polio scare era. And at that time, there were the most polio infections annually in the United States ever. So about 35,000 individuals a year in the United States developed an advanced form of polio that caused paralysis. Many of them became wheelchair-bound. Some of them lost basically all motor function and would have to have iron lungs, etc. So polio causes paralysis. It affects the nervous system. This became the object of research, finding a cure for polio. So let me begin in 1908, when the rhesus monkey research really gets started. In 1908, German researchers Karl Landsteiner and Edwin Popper demonstrated the cause of paralysis through spinal infection with poliovirus. So they first failed to transfer the disease from humans to mice. They were trying to show, okay, what happens if we give mice polio? Nothing. Then they tried guinea pigs and rabbits. And finally, they did some work on monkeys. What they did is they found an Austrian child who had died of polio, ground up his spinal cord, made a serum out of that, and injected it into two monkeys. Both of the monkeys developed symptoms of paralysis, and one of those monkeys, the rhesus monkey, developed generalized symptoms of polio disease, and it looked a lot like polio in humans. However, this was an artificial adaptation of polio virus to the rhesus monkey. It wasn't understood at the time, but it didn't accurately model what the disease looked like in humans. In human environmental transmission of polio, the virus first colonizes the gut, and only when the immune system kind of fails to contain it in the gut, it makes a jump into the spinal cord and the brainstem, and so it affects the nervous system, and that's where the paralysis takes hold. But most people who get the virus, their immune system is able to contain it to the gut, and it doesn't cause these major effects. Now, what Landsteiner and Popper did in their lab in 1908 did not model this in the rhesus monkeys. They basically loaded the respiratory system of the rhesus monkey with enough virus that it made a jump directly from the respiratory system to the nervous system. And so the model that they used to test for cures wasn't really the same type of disease that was happening to the humans who were getting polio. Nonetheless, it seemed a big deal, and it was a big deal, that they discovered that rhesus monkeys could suffer from some of the same symptoms as human patients for polio. And this spurred a kind of huge philanthropic and government investment in saying, let's get our hands on more of these rhesus monkeys. They seem to be the only species that gets polio like humans. This research, you know, continued, but it was plagued by problems that were both scientific from the bad model and also ethical, because it wasn't just that they were exploiting monkeys. They were also testing all of these experimental serums on all kinds of humans in unethical environments, right? Children were getting experimental polio vaccine, and a few of them were actually infected by the vaccine. They wouldn't have had polio otherwise. They were testing it on prisoners, and in some cases they found research subjects in the colonial world. They went and found populations they could test on in other countries as well. And in all of these cases, there weren't really modern legal protections, which are today even often not adequate to really protect humans who are being researched on. So vivisection is something we should think about that's also done to humans, although, you know, this story is going to be largely about animal vivisection. So I've talked about how the rhesus model did not actually create the same type of disease that humans were experiencing. And nonetheless, there was excitement that for the first time these laboratories were producing what looked like a scientific model for doing research on animals. So there was a huge investment in getting more of these animals. And about 10,000 rhesus macaques, rhesus monkeys, were imported annually from India each year in the 1930s. So that's when the research really starts taking off, and that's also when the number of cases in the US was really starting to skyrocket. In India, it's important to remember that India was colonized by the British, and it was the British colonial government that made the decisions on what went in and what went out. So the British, you know, there were many Indians who participated in that colonial government, but the British government was in control, and they gave free rein for the harvesting of these animals in northern India and for the export of them through the port in Calcutta. Now, there was resistance to this in India. And actually, India passes one of the world's most progressive animal welfare laws in 1935. So there's actually a legal basis for people to say, well, this needs to at least be looked at and regulated. We need to make sure, okay, you're going to allow the research, you're going to allow the trade in primates, but you have to at least guarantee that they're, you know, not being cruelly treated and killed in transport. Led by Indian animal activists, there were letter writing campaigns, petition campaigns, and, you know, I actually found these old documents of dozens of signatures from the United States and Canada being sent on petitions to the British colonial government, asking them to stop these exports. The other thing that was going on at this time, this is now the mid-30s we're talking about, is World War II is about to break out. And what happens then is the ships that they're using to transport these monkeys to the U.S., that trade gets disrupted because of the war, because it's no longer so safe to be operating trade ships on the open seas. And what happens at that moment is there's this one scientist, this one researcher, C.R. Carpenter, Clarence Ray Carpenter. I'm going to show you his picture. That's him holding his book entitled Primates. He published an article in the journal Science in 1940, calling for the United States government to negotiate with the British colonial government to allow more imports of these monkeys from India. He didn't just say the government should be doing this. Carpenter also actually went out and used the resources of Columbia University, where he was on the faculty, to actually make the first primate lab happen with rhesus monkeys. So the story is really interesting because Columbia University, where he was a faculty member, had just opened what they called at that time a school of tropical medicine. These were usually medical schools set up to be in quote-unquote third world locations that were meant to study the specific tropical maladies of those darker skinned peoples. It was kind of a paternalistic, we're going to come down and set up these medical institutions to take care of your very different medical problems that you have in this tropical setting, colonial setting. So that school of tropical medicine, he goes down there and he gets his colleagues there to help him secure access to a small island in the southeast of the Puerto Rican archipelago, and it's called Cayo Santiago. This is an aerial picture from Carpenter's papers. And what he did was then he went to India, paid harvesters there for a large shipment of monkeys, and brought over to this island 409 Indian rhesus macaques and released them. And this was his demonstration that, you know, the government could actually collectively start to procure these animals as what they called research resources. A self-sustaining population in the Americas or in U.S.-occupied territory, controlled by the U.S., so they wouldn't have to go abroad when there were these animal welfare people kind of harassing them, or where there were wartime shipping disruptions. So it's important to remember that the United States took over Puerto Rico in 1898 during the Spanish-American War. And so it was kind of a new thing that U.S. institutions were kind of taking over a lot of the institutional space in Puerto Rico. And a lot of scholars looking at this period talk about Puerto Rico itself as being viewed by Americans as a kind of laboratory, as a laboratory for development. We're going to do what we can to improve the lot of these underdeveloped peoples, was the kind of discourse they used. So Carpenter uses these monkeys taken from India and puts them into this new institution, the School of Tropical Medicine in Puerto Rico, in a moment where it's viewed as a kind of modernization tool to have science being brought to the colonies. At this time, humans from India were not allowed to immigrate to the United States under Asian exclusion laws. Only very small numbers were able to come over. And that immigration regime wasn't liberalized until 1965. So it's really interesting to me that Carpenter is bringing over monkeys as supreme models for the human body at a time when the humans from that place were not allowed to come in. The ways that this kind of experiment in a monkey colony were talked about in the press are pretty interesting. So I'm just going to give you, what happened? A couple of examples here. This key got stuck. That's what happened. This is a picture of a rhesus monkey being tagged so they could identify it individually. And these are some of the quotes from Life magazine about the opening of the Cayo Santiago field station. Because he is considered sacred in India, the rhesus is domineering, undisciplined, and bad-tempered. So the stereotype is that Hindus worship animals, and that creates this bad relationship between humans and animals. The animals get spoiled, and there's this improper relationship of, you know, the humans should be dominating the animals, but in reality, because the Hindus are too sentimental about animals or whatever, the animal dominates them. And then the other kind of idea, Mahatma Gandhi is preaching against the exportation of the sacred rhesus monkey for the rejuvenation of decadent Westerners. There were various rumors about what this, these animals were being used for. I couldn't actually find a quote confirming that Gandhi said anything like this. I looked for it, but I don't know exactly where that idea was coming from. But again, it was this quote was meant to kind of suggest that the government needs to take some action because, again, in India they have these kind of weird ideas about animals and don't understand the scientific value of them. Carpenter specifically said we need these monkeys for polio research, even though he himself didn't do polio research and he just wanted to study their behavior. It was pretty self-interested on his part. Now, the Puerto Rican stereotypes were operative here too, and the weird thing about it is it made them kind of misunderstand the animals. The Puerto Rican islands in the press were kind of portrayed as this natural space of the tropics where animals would just be free and would be unencumbered by humans. And you get these kind of postcard tourist views of Puerto Rico in the press. So I'm going to read this from the Illustrated London News. That's an image they printed of Cayo Santiago in the background, this little shadow from the Puerto Rican main. And they write, "It is a rocky land covered with shade trees and thickets, some of it sandy depression, fringed with coconut palms, and some flat, earthly expanses in which root crops have been planted for the future islanders," meaning the monkeys. "It is, in effect, a miniature Pitcairn island dropped into a shallow sea of parrot-winged blue, jade green, or wrinkled copper, according to the caprice of the sun and the wind." The environment that it's describing was actually an imported environment that Carpenter's colleagues landscaped into the island, presuming that these monkeys would naturally feed off of root vegetables and from palm trees. The monkeys just tore all that stuff out of the ground immediately, and the other thing they did was they swam. They swam over to the Puerto Rican main and escaped. So the experiment failed in certain ways immediately. And it was because of these colonialist ideas about both the monkeys and the island that they didn't seem to understand how the monkeys would actually behave. Okay. Now, let me introduce some of the US side to what's going on in terms of the public fears about polio, because that's going to continue driving the demand for rhesus monkeys. And so I want to introduce this term. It's a big word, xenotransplantation. All it means is the transplantation of biological material from one species to another. So you may have heard the most famous examples of this are the artificial hearts, or not artificial hearts, but hearts transplanted from primates to humans, or more recently from pigs to humans. But polio research involves xenotransplantation as well. The spinal material from monkeys and humans being transplanted into each other. And it's important to remember that that's what was going on in the medicine, because the public was really scared of this. It was a new idea, and it provoked a lot of public fears about both medical science and the monkeys themselves. So this is how they got the spinal material. Spinal taps, also called lumbar punctures. And usually it's done with a patient lying on their back and a long needle inserted into the central spinal cord. And here it shows that it has to go past the vertebrae and pierce this epidural layer to get to the fluid that goes around the spinal cord. That's the stuff that they were looking for, because that's where the virus would take hold and affect the nervous system. And spinal taps are really painful. So both the monkeys and the humans were experiencing this in the research lab. The visual image of spinal taps in polio research provoked fears that medical science was becoming too radical, that it was an unregulated set of technologies. And it also provoked fears that these kind of foreign animals were being put inside, like, our spinal columns and touching our nervous systems. That's the system that control, you know, the mind uses to control the body. So it got to this really intimate fears that people had over losing control of their individual autonomy and freedom. Nonetheless, medical research on primates seemed to be the only path forward that people understood as a kind of way of containing poliovirus. Unlike a lot of other diseases, polio couldn't easily be contained in space. You couldn't just quarantine polio away. You couldn't just say it's only immigrants or people living in close quarters in cities who bring this virus to us. It was spreading across places understood to be sanitary. It was spreading in suburban and rural communities, segregated communities that were primarily white and middle class. Remember, this was the era of Jim Crow, too. And it was impacting children a lot of the time. So we would get these associations of the innocent young white child who is crippled by polio. Now, one of the interesting things that happens because of both the real deep fear of polio and the new publicization about this invasive science that was going in and crushing up people's spinal cords and crushing up animals' spinal cords and injecting them into each other is a bunch of horror films started depicting spinal taps and animal experimentation. So I'm just going to give you, here's a scene from one of my favorite movies now. It's called The Ape, and it's about this type of research. And the film really shows these fears because in the film, it's not a monkey, it's an ape. And the ape looks much more threatening, the ape's body is much bigger, and the ape really represents medical science, kind of coming in and bullying innocent humans. Is the way that it's portrayed. And the doctor is portrayed as an ape too. And so you're not gonna really see that in this scene, but I'm gonna show you the doctor performing a spinal tap. And what he's doing is this man has had his spinal column injured, and he realizes that he can treat a local polio patient if he just, instead of helping this man survive, just kills him and takes his spinal material. So I'm gonna show you this. This is a real movie from 1940 called The Ape, and starring Boris Karloff, who was a famous horror actor. Hopefully we can see this. Flash forward to 1955. Jonas Salk's polio vaccine is distributed on a mass scale in the United States. People are immunized, and for the first time, there's a steep decline in polio infection. At this point, what it took to create that polio vaccine was about 120,000 rhesus monkeys imported from India annually. So the numbers got huge, way higher than in the 1930s. They got up to an environmentally unsustainable point. The populations were threatened to be dwindling or extinct. And at this time, in 1955, the Indian government is now independent. India achieved its independence from Britain in 1945, and interesting things happens. Just as these vaccines get unloaded, the Indian government under Prime Minister Jawaharlal Nehru puts a ban on primate exports to the US because they find out that the US is experimenting on chimpanzees in its defense programs, radiological experiments on chimpanzees. And India is a leader of the newly independent non-aligned countries who are against nuclear programs. The Indian government stops exports.
Is there a sound happening out there?
Yeah. Sorry, I got distracted. The Indian government stops these exports, and American officials, once again like Carpenter, start feeling like, whoa, we have to do something to replace the supply of rhesus monkeys. We have to do something now. And they develop a committee at the CDC called the Committee to Develop a National Primate Committee or something like that. And This is in 1956. So for the first time, we have the national government actually saying, okay, now let's develop a rhesus monkey program. Sorry, I was missing this page. In the early meetings of the committee, they emphasized how the decolonization of primate range states, states where monkeys, chimpanzees, gorillas, other species that were considered in research, the threat that those countries becoming independent posed to research. So, quote, this is one committee member, quote, "This problem of supplying monkeys is now acute, and there's no assurance whatever that it will improve. The immediate reason is the necessity for a polio vaccine, but in the recent past, an embargo on Indian monkeys was nearly catastrophic." So referencing the Indian ban. One member of the committee placed rhesus monkeys on par with other important raw materials of the military. Quote, "The rhesus monkey is almost as strategic material as tungsten and tin and rubber. We may do to the rhesus what we've almost done to the buffalo here in the United States. It would seem, therefore, that any device that would bring together people who could make maximum national use of the animals would be a very worthwhile procedure," end quote. Now, given the long association of primates with Africa, and you see this in a lot of films that kind of place the chimpanzee or the gorilla in the jungle, the committee first says, okay, let's go to Africa and find some different species of primates to do research on. They do this in 1960 and 1961, attempting to set up free-ranging colonies of chimpanzees in the Congo and a multi-species primate institution in Kenya. The problem was that suddenly both of those countries gained independence in between 1960 and 1962. And the institution that the U.S. researchers were trying to pair with in the Congo was run by Belgian scientists who were being kicked out. And in dramatic fashion, the UN actually has to come in and airlift the chimpanzees out of that research institution because of the kind of situation, the decolonizing situation in the Congo. The scientists are kicked out, and they're worried that the chimpanzees are going to be killed or are going to just be released, and you know, they want to keep control of them. So the demise of these attempts to, you know, start new institutions in Africa really kind of ended this whole tropical fantasy of we're going to have primates living in their own habitats and use them for research. Now all of the focus was shifting back to importation. And, you know, the NIH committee's work shifts back to the domestic location. So they begin to think then, this is interesting, because they're no longer importing them directly, the committee members actually start thinking about what it means to care for rhesus monkeys for a lifetime, because they want them to breed. They want the monkeys to be cared for enough to reproduce their own populations, even if they're not really interested in their welfare in a more broad sense. So unlike imported monkeys, the domestically bred rhesus monkey needed to be maintained in a form of captivity that allowed for easy exploitation in science, as well as for the animals to breed. In committee meetings, a major controversy centered on whether keeping the monkeys in captivity went against their proper care. Harry Harlow and Leon Schmidt were two primate researchers who argued in favor of enclosed indoor facilities. And Harlow had demonstrated the apparent success of such facilities at his own lab in Wisconsin. And he said that he had done this, quote, in very small quarters. He advocated small cages specifically. Not everybody thought that way. By contrast, Irving Wright, a Cornell cardiologist, said, quote, "I was not quite sure that locking up monkeys up in cages is really giving them a natural environment. If you're going to study their long-term generation after generation effect, I wouldn't expect it to be true of humans, and I don't see why that would work for monkeys." The chair of the committee, George Birch, who was also a cardiologist at Tulane, said that there was the potential effect that confinement would, quote, "change their personalities, affecting the research." And Irving Wright once again said that captivity might, quote, "affect their outlook on life." In the era of importing them, just sending them over from India, scientists never said these kind of things. But now they were actually thinking about what it meant to set up an institution. oddly, that meant recognizing certain, you know, moments that they have personalities, that they might have intelligence, that they might have desires. Things that seem in conflict with exploiting them for research, right? Now, James Watt is a researcher who was involved in this conversation, and he had worked at Cayo Santiago in Puerto Rico with the monkeys. And he argued that he was actually someone who was really worried that Russia was going to advance over the U.S. in primates, was going to have better primate facilities. And he said, we should do it both. We should do more than what Russia does. We should do everything. We should have indoor captive facilities and free-ranging facilities. He said, quote, when talking about a colony, we are shooting for a diverse group of workers. I thought that was interesting that he calls the rhesus monkeys workers. So the committee eventually does set up what was later called the Regional Primate Research Centers. Recently, after 2001, that was changed to the National Primate Research Centers. There are 8 facilities today. And these were a mix of indoor and outdoor facilities, but most of the animals were kept indoors. And the largest represented species was rhesus monkeys. So directly grows out of these debates over polio and the supply of rhesus for polio vaccine, but then it becomes a kind of national institution, accidentally making rhesus monkeys, like, you know, it was the only medical logic for it was that rhesus were good for polio, but suddenly all of these researchers in other fields want to try their own experiments on rhesus monkeys because the polio thing seemed to demonstrate that they were a lot like humans. And much of the design of these institutions had to do with Harlow's influence on the committee. And many of you may have heard of Harry Harlow's experimentation. He's infamous for having done these maternal deprivation experiments on infant rhesus monkeys. I think I have a picture of that here. Yeah, that's Harlow with an infant rhesus. And this is like a puppet of a mother. But he's actually taken away the living mother from that infant. Now, keep this in mind because a current petition is going around to stop these experiments from being restarted at University of Wisconsin, because they're now going to do it for PTSD research and are going to take neural scans of the brains and then dissect the brains of these rhesus monkeys who've been withheld affection as infants. So it's going to try to prove something about the way that trauma works based on traumatic childhood development. That's the goal of the research, but we can talk more about it if you want later. So Harlow's work, this is what I'm going to kind of argue, Harlow's work contributed to the facilities, to these institutions. You know, we've talked a little bit about his research, but people don't usually say what Harlow did to the institutions, the primate institutions. Harlow's work helped break the rhesus monkey of its association with the colonial world. The rhesus monkey was no longer this foreign animal coming into the U.S. It was no longer associated with the jungle, with tropical islands. Harlow's work helped to domesticate the rhesus monkey, to make it look like it was something that belonged in the modern American laboratory and that was contributing to medical progress. So depriving rhesus of social interaction and affection through these experiments, Harlow attempted to prove the evolutionary significance of mother love by brutally withholding it from young rhesus monkeys. But at the same time, he was showing that you could breed successfully a reproducing population of rhesus monkeys without those basic social needs being satisfied. You could put them in cages, you could separate them from each other, take social beings away from their social community, and you could still have a reproducing group of rhesus monkeys that can be exploited. This was, in the scientists' minds, good because you could standardize the population. You could make sure that they didn't pass around tuberculosis. He could market that, and he did. He sold large numbers of monkeys to other labs, advertising that because he kept them in indoor facilities, separated from one another, he could certify that they were tuberculosis-free. So this move from international importation, the primate trade, to domestic breeding was something that was first spurred because decolonizing countries, Asian and African states, didn't want American researchers to just be able to come in and take whatever they wanted. And weirdly, the result of that is through the efforts of people like Harry Harlow, okay, we're going to just import a small amount of these monkeys, and then we're going to start our own breeding operations and start to view these animals as conscripts in the fight for national health. I'm going to end by just talking briefly about how this changed the language around primate research. There were two words they adopted at this moment. First, they made the explicit decision to stop using the word monkey or ape and to use the generic word primate. This is the quote, it has a lot better public relations value. Because people had always viewed monkeys and apes as circus performing animals, as these jungle creatures who were, you know, featured in horror films and adventure tales about the colonial world. And they didn't want that sensational association that often carried with it certain kind of racial stereotypes. Aggressive monkey breaking, ape breaking into the lab, a dark-skinned primate breaking into a lab in the American context has this whole association with the history of kind of stereotypes about African-American men and rape and lynching going back to the era of slavery. So they wanted to desensationalize these animals by calling them primates. Second, they actually started scratching out in their proposals for these centers the word subhuman, and started using the word non-human. This is the language that we use in our activism to say they're not lower than us, they're just different from us, right? The scientists did that first, and we should really think about why they wanted to do that, because it seems like in order to justify their research, they were trying to promote the public image of these animals, make Americans feel comfortable with them and not look at them as foreign. And establishing this kind of Darwinian, you know, relation, you're just a different species, we've evolved separately, whatever, was a kind of great way for them to sell the institutions. But then there's an ambivalence to it, because, well, doesn't that kind of open the door then for saying, if they're so like us, maybe we shouldn't exploit them? And I want to just throw out there, maybe, this is speculative, but maybe, it was inevitable that animal activists would end up in this kind of fight that we're having right now around these primate labs, because that whole language, the attempt to promote a certain sense of the equality, or not equality, but the idea that they're not below humans, promoting that idea at the same time that they were domesticating them by bringing them into the modern laboratory and destroying their social networks and their normal ecologies of living, was creating a contradiction. So the fight that activists have with labs and the response that labs do, which is to militarize their security, to lock down, to keep us out, to have more intricate forms of security based on a kind of paranoia that animal activists are going to invade, I think was built into this whole history. That came about because decolonizing nations stopped giving unfettered access to American medical professionals. And in turn, the American medical establishment started to try to promote a certain kind of public image for the laboratory primate, to try to kind of put a good face on keeping them in a tiny jail, basically. So every time, you know, I use the word non-human, this whole story kind of comes back to me. And I still use the word non-human because I believe we have to kind of point out the everyday kind of discrimination that our language has built into it to assume that animals are lower. But sometimes pointing that out in the past has been used to advance the cause of the suffering of animals. So I want us to think about that contradiction as an outgrowth of these international relationships that brought about the National Primate Centers. Thank you.